Purchasing power parity comes in two flavors. There's absolute purchasing power parity theory, and there's relative purchasing power parity theory. We can speak of the goods prices internationally and domestically being linked by the exchange rate, or we can speak of inflation rates domestically and internationally being linked by the exchange rate changes. One almost has to ask, what is the origin of this theory so that it could have been established and accepted for as long as it was accepted? So we have the purchasing power parity theory rewritten E equals P over P star, which almost makes no sense as a theory determining the exchange rate. It makes sense for each good for whom the price is being compared. But when we aggregate from one good to all goods in the price index, it is hard to accept that the exchange rate is determined by the price levels across international boundaries. In fact, we will easily come to the conclusion that the exchange rate is determined by many things beyond the price levels of goods. So there are many other variables or factors that belong in that exchange rate equation. One of my major criticisms of purchasing power parity is that we cannot go from the level of a good being traded to the level of all goods in the consumer price index. It's a fallacy of composition, but we get away with it if we make the assumption that all goods in the country are tradable goods, and you import everything you consume and you export everything that you produce. That is the most likely scenario under which purchasing power parity will obtain. And certainly if your economy is a small economy, it certainly is an open economy if all of your goods are being traded. But if it's also a small economy, it's very likely that purchasing power parity will apply reasonably well as a theory of exchange rate determination. So I say that purchasing power parity might hold at the level of a good that is traded, but we cannot generalize from a single traded good or a set of traded goods to all prices of all goods in the domestic consumer price index. Here we have it then. You cannot easily compare the US CPI with the British CPI and expect that the ratio of these two CPIs will be the exchange rate. We have kind of a theory, but it is certainly not a robust theory because of that fallacy of composition. Here is another perspective on that. Because all goods in the CPI of a country will not be tradable goods, then as soon as the non-traded goods sector is large enough and the prices in the non-traded goods sector are determined by domestic demand and supply, we move away from a theory of exchange rates being determined by the price levels, because the non-traded prices are weighted more heavily in that formula determining the CPI. The larger is alpha, the more accurate is the assumption concerning the domestic price level being approximated by traded prices or correlating with traded prices. We therefore reiterate our point that PPP works better when alpha is large, when the country is heavily dependent on international trade. Interest rate parity. This is the asset equivalent of the law of one price, which is another name for purchasing power parity theory. The law of one price effectively says that the price of a given good will be the same all around the world, adjusted by the exchange rate value. IRP theory states that the return on equivalent assets internationally should be the same. Since the returns on assets involve a time dimension and asset investments require foreign exchange rates to be considered, the simplest analysis compares two countries and two assets. The assets here are going to be interest-bearing assets domestically and internationally, and exchange rates today and exchange rates in the future. The exchange rate in the future could be determined by a speculative price, or it could be a forward market contract in the foreign exchange market. So a forward contract will be different than a spot exchange, and therefore those would be considered two different assets. Again, we are trying to say the simplest analysis compares two countries and two assets, the interest-bearing asset and the exchange rate-based asset. Here is how the analysis works. We have an investor who can invest in a domestic interest-bearing asset. So we start in the upper left-hand corner. You can take your US dollars today and invest them at some interest rate for a period such as 1 year, knowing the interest rate and knowing what level of return you will obtain after 1 year. So we have your dollar investment times 1 plus I, where I is the interest rate, yielding the dollar amount to be received at the end of the contract period. The alternative is to invest in a foreign asset, in which case the investor has to convert her dollars into foreign currency, invest in the foreign asset, and at the end of the period, reconvert her foreign currency back to domestic currency. There is risk if you cannot contract the price at which you trade the foreign exchange, even if you know the foreign interest rate. So we say you have a sure thing, the domestic investment, and a risky thing, the foreign investment. It need not be risky if the forward market price for foreign currency is predetermined, but then the individual would have a clear decision, and the individual will allocate her portfolio across domestic and foreign interest-bearing assets based on her own desire to diversify. But if the returns are all known, it really doesn't matter where you invest. The better arrangement here would be to have a risky foreign investment, so the investment might yield a known return in the foreign country, but the risk would be the foreign exchange risk. So instead of F1, we have E1, the exchange rate in the future. And since an exchange rate in the future does not exist today, it would have to be an expected exchange rate. And that would be how we measure the riskiness of the foreign investment. Working with the sure thing, the forward contracted investment, we will be able to determine the equilibrium between domestic investment and foreign investment, and if there is a disequilibrium, more resources will go to the country that has the higher return. And like water finding its own level, the interest rates will adjust so that the returns are the same. So, in the case of Mexico in 1994, there was an inflow of funds into Mexico. And this is largely NAFTA based. Mexico signed the NAFTA, and effective January 1, 1994, many US dollar investments flowed into Mexico. There are several reasons for this. One can say that the opening of the trade floodgates with the free trade agreement would naturally result in an inflow of foreign currencies into the country where the return on interest-bearing assets is higher. So the question arises, why was the return on Mexican assets higher? Is it because Mexico artificially pushed the rates up, or alternatively, the US pushed its rates down? Or was it in the foreign exchange markets that the disequilibrium occurred? One could say, based on this first equation, that if in the case of, let's Mexico be the domestic economy, so the left-hand side of our equation is the Mexican investment return. So we're saying that the return in Mexico is higher, and if that is the case, there's a greater than sign rather than equal sign. The way to fix that would be either to lower the interest rate in Mexico, or to raise the US interest rate, or to raise the F1 value, or the expected E1 value. What does it mean to raise the expected E1 value? It means that there's an expectation that foreign currency will rise in price in the future, so that the expectation would have been that the US dollar would appreciate in value in the future. People are invested in Mexico because they're buying cheap US dollars, moving them to Mexico, expecting the price of the dollar to go up, and they're going to get a windfall of some sort on that appreciating US dollar or depreciating Mexican peso. Come payday, the Mexican peso needs to go down in value. There's pressure for that to go down so that the investors can actually capture their higher return by investing in Mexico. You can almost say then that the Mexican peso had to devalue because the Mexican interest rate was sufficiently higher than the US interest rate. What we know happened is that the US started to raise its interest rate, and that sort of closed the gap so that the equation came back towards an equilibrium. The rest of the equation would be that the expectation that the dollar will increase in price will be mitigated if the government in the US or the central bank is raising the interest rate. Of course, if the US government is going to raise the domestic interest rate, then monies would naturally flow back into the United States because the return here is getting more attractive than it used to be. There are problems with both interest rate parity theory and purchasing power parity theory. Notice they only focus on prices and they never tell you the mechanism whereby the price is determined. It's sort of like focusing on the CPI without asking questions about the quantities of goods that are being produced or bought, or focusing on the Dow Jones Industrial Average without speaking to the amount of trade in the stocks that is occurring. So these theories are what I would call half-baked theories because they focus on prices as though they are sui generis, as though these four prices are intricately related, with no questions being asked about where the prices are coming from. One has to remember that the question as to where the price is coming from has to be addressed. Otherwise, the theory is not well articulated. So at the bottom of our screen, we have the risky counterpart. The risky counterpart of interest parity is called uncovered interest rate parity, and the risk-free version is called covered interest rate parity because you've covered yourself with a forward market contract.